I'm Marty Raaymakers. I have been a certified peer support specialist for a while, but my story when recovery starts a long, long time before that. I was ill as a kid, but I wasn't diagnosed until 1988. And even then, what I found is from 1988 until 1996, I thought that recovery was taking my meds, seeing my psychiatrist, and seeing my therapist. And I thought that that was all that life had to offer. I thought that that was as good as life was going to get. It still wasn't working out for me. I had a lot of med side effects, and I was struggling, and I was homeless again. And at the end of my last 3 years of homelessness, which was in late 1995, I went to a NAMI meeting and walked up to this guy, and we started talking, and he gave me this application for Section 8 housing. When he gave me that application for Section 8 housing, it was the first time in my life that I had been able to even think about maintaining a house. He walked up to me and said, you know, I've got this application here for Section 8 housing, and it's specifically for persons with a mental illness. And I remember thinking to myself at that time, boy, do I qualify. Because I'd been in and out of houses and in and out of homes and homeless for a lot of points in my life. So I got that application and I got an apartment. And later on, he walks up to me and he says, you know, I need a consumer council rep. Would you be interested? And from that time on, my life changed. In my county, I didn't know anybody who had a mental illness that was well. No matter how hard I looked around and how hard I tried to find somebody, I couldn't find anybody who was well. And in 1996, from that chance meeting with this guy, I got to go to Washington, D.C. to go to a NAMI conference. And what I found there were other people who had a mental illness who were well. I don't know exactly what I was supposed to do at that conference. I know that what I did is that I spent my time trying to chase people down in the halls, asking them how they'd gotten well. You know, if I found someone and that they had told me that they had a mental illness and they were well, I would literally be chasing them down the halls, asking them what I could do, because that was the first time I ever knew that recovery wasn't just taking your medicine, seeing your psychiatrist, and seeing your therapist. That was the best gift, when I got that. So I look back now and I go, you know, I wasted 6, 8, 10 years of my life not even knowing that there was a chance for me to get into recovery, and that recovery wasn't even what I thought it was once I'd heard of it. And now I know that recovery is about life. It's the way you deal with life and the excitement that life has to bring you. After I got the apartment and I went to the NAMI conference and I came back, I had a chance to start doing meetings with people from the state of Michigan, where I had the opportunity to tell them what I thought of services in the state of Michigan. And for me, that was really interesting because all my services were interesting. They weren't the best. They didn't fit me well. Even if the program was well designed, it just wasn't something that I fit in well. So when I started going into meetings up at the state of Michigan, the first thing that I heard about was person-centered planning. And they told me that I actually got to help write my treatment plan, that I was supposed to be able to invite people that I wanted to my person-centered planning meeting. And my favorite story about person-centered planning happened a couple of years ago, well, actually a little bit longer. But the guy, I was in a room with my therapist. I said, you know, I want to have a person-centered planning meeting. And he said, I'll retire first. And he did, because, you know, and all I wanted was to have a planning meeting to tell people what I wanted. And it was like he didn't want to have that happen. So I learned about person-centered planning, and I started talking about person-centered planning and started talking about how important it was. I didn't realize, I mean, I knew it was important, but I didn't realize just how important it was until about 2000 and 2001. And then I had a chance to do a person-centered plan that just lit my fire. And once that person-centered plan happened, I have never looked back. My recovery has been really, really high in that I learned to look at things that bothered me and things that were upsetting me that were in my life, and I managed to get most of those out. I managed to take most of those out so they don't happen anymore. I have put more things in my life that I enjoy, which has really helped me get into a high level of recovery. You know, once I find that I'm not just sitting alone in my house, totally depressed, I have a tendency to get out and enjoy life more now. In 2006, I took a motorcycle and rode around the country for 6 months. I learned a lot. I learned that when there's an ice storm in Oklahoma and the temperature's higher in Mississippi and people are telling you that you should go south in case the ice storm's going to come and get you, that it just means that it's going to be like lots of rain and you're going to be drenched and you're riding for like 5 hours in rain trying to get to the next campground. It was one of those really strange experiences. I wouldn't trade it for anything in the world. It was just really, really important. It just helped my growth level just so much. I came back from those 6 months with a level of confidence and knowing that I could handle things that I didn't have before. Other things that I learned, I learned a lot about recovery in meetings. And that sounds strange. I went to a bunch of meetings on person-centered planning, and I thought that people got a notebook instead of a person-centered plan. I went to meetings on jails and prisons and said, well, why and how are you doing this? This is not okay. Talked about state hospitals, and I worked with recipient rights, and heard stories there that would curl my hair, you know, and mine's pretty straight, as you see. My own recovery, it got really strong in 2001. There are certain things I learned to watch out for now. I don't tolerate med side effects well. And I not only don't tolerate them in myself, I don't tolerate them in other people. I've learned to be very careful and to look out for them a lot. I've found that med side effects sometimes can, the side effects can be worse than the disease. And I've had to learn how I wanted to deal with that when that happened in my own life, how I wanted to maintain my wellness. One of the things that I've had to do is I've had to get really awesome coping skills. You can't stop getting coping skills, but I've had to maintain my level of recovery from, I go to bed if I get a crick in my neck, or if my back starts to feel tight. I no longer have a luxury that I used to have of, pushing the envelope. At the same time, the trade-off is that I'm well. I've not been ill in a long time. At the end of the 6 months when I was traveling around on the motorcycle, I'd planned on it being a lot longer. And instead what happened is I came back because one of my granddaughters inherited my bipolar disorder. And kids who have a mental illness, they're so special. My granddaughter's hyperactive, and she loves to run around, and the good side of it is that she's just a wonderful artist and a wonderful writer, and she's just so loving. And when I found out that she was ill, I came back to Michigan, and we started talking about different meds and things that might work, and, I came back to be with her and to make sure that she succeeded. Because one of the things that happens in peer support is it's not just peer support towards people who are adults. It's peer support towards kids who are ill as well. It's one of those things I think we're going to do more and more of as time passes on. Because the things that I've learned help Jenny. It's like, well, Jay, you can't live inside your skin right now. That's what you're telling me. What can we do that'll help you do that? Because a problem for kids sometimes is not being able to live inside their skin. They don't feel like they can be inside of it. And so Jenny and I are able to talk that through, and we talk that down. We talk to Jenny a lot more than we do the other two, because we have to help her think through her actions sometimes. She's a little impulsive. We lost Jenny one time at Disney World when she took off on a scooter and it took us 45 minutes to find her. One of the things I did that helped me get into and stay in recovery was when I got well after I did that person-centered plan, I did 2 CDs on recovery. One is called Recovery That Rocks and the other one's called Views from the Trail. Views from the Trail is more about my personal story, just about things I wish I'd known about when I couldn't figure out what recovery was. And Recovery That Rocks is a presentation that I did for 3 or 4 years about getting better and feeling better and getting into wellness. One of the organizations that I've been really involved with, especially for the last 6 to 8 years, has been NAMI at the national level. I was chair of the Consumer Council for 4 years, and at that time we chose to try to change the mission of NAMI. We wanted to get away from the word eradicate and change it more to hope and wellness and recovery and resiliency. That happened this last year. I think that one of the things that it's hard as an advocate to do is to listen to people when they give you their ideas and you want to make changes. And you wish that those changes would happen immediately. And that never seems to happen that way. You sit there and you tweak this and you tweak that and you try to change things. And you have to wait until all those stars drop into alignment for something to happen. And this last year, the Consumer Council requested that I put forth a resolution to where we change the mission statement of NAMI. And we were able to do that this year. And that just was really, really exciting. Now I'm on the NAMI National Board. And it's been an interesting experience. I wish I was back being Consumer Council Chair again. It was much harder work, but I could say a lot more things. Now I find I have to be a board member and maintain the board alignment. It's not near as much fun. I got the sweatshirt Feisty and Noncompliant when I went over to Kalamazoo to speak. And I saw them and I knew that I had to have it. I'd had a button that said Feisty and Noncompliant. Then I saw the sweatshirt. And there was a purple one that was there. I bought it on the spot. And then they said, well, you know, we have hoodies, and they didn't have one my size. So I ordered a hoodie and they shipped it to me a couple of weeks later. I think that being feisty and noncompliant in your treatment sometimes is real important. When it came to my medications, if I would have listened to the psychiatrists and just stayed on those same medications, I would have never gotten well. It was a chance post to an email list I was on by a person who has bipolar disorder that's a psychiatrist. He said, have you ever noticed that when these two meds are prescribed in combination that this happens? Luckily, I keep med logs, because at that time I said, oh my gosh, that's what's happened to me. So I went to see my psychiatrist and I said, well, you know, I want off these medications. I think they're making me more ill. And they said, no. And I kept trying and trying and trying to change meds. And I ended up going off them without permission that time. And I thought what was neat was that my family, my NAMI family, actually supported me during that time. They took the time to make sure that I was okay. They did a lot of maintenance. And one of my friends said, you know, Marty's gaining a lot of weight. She's well over 300 pounds, 350 pounds, and she's gaining more weight all the time. You know, what's happening is we're going to lose her anyway. And at that point, when we looked at the fact that my meds were hurting me at that time, and we got them stopped, I no longer feel terribly physically. I mean, I no longer feel bad physically. I'm able to move more, enjoy myself, get out and move around. That had never happened before. So I'm really glad that I chose to make that step. One of the goals that we had for a long time was that I stop cutting. And one of the things that happened is I found out that I had to be happier to stop cutting. It wasn't working for me to try to stop cutting and not have anything that I felt good about in my life. So I was able to stop cutting, but it was about 4 years later, and I found out that when I'm happy, it's a lot easier to stop cutting. When I have meaningful goals and a meaningful life, it's a lot easier to stop cutting. And, you know, if there's a message I'd like to take for people to take away about that, it's that you can't stop that right away all the time. You know, each year I'd stop it, and the times would get longer and longer between times I'd cut. Then each October would roll around, and that was like an anniversary date for me, and I'd recut. And I'd recut. And it took about 3 years to break that. A blessing was a therapist for me who said, you know, it's been so long since you did it the last time. I know next time you're just going to be able to make it through October. And then 1 year in about December, she talked to me and said, do you remember that October date? Do you realize that it passed? And that was able to happen. One of the things that's truly a delight in the state of Michigan is that there's a recovery council. I was asked to be a member of it, and to have watched the council learn that they have some power and control has been great. We started out with a bunch of people who weren't sure what this council was going to do, where it was going to go, or if it was going to make a difference. And people found out they had a voice and that the state would listen to them when they needed something. There have been a couple of things about measurement tools where people wanted to look at different things in the state, and the Recovery Council came out with an opinion on what they wanted, that they wanted the tools of measurement that are used in this state to be friendly to consumers, friendly to people who happen to have a mental illness, friendly to people that need to use them. A measurement tool needs to be something that people want to participate in because they like it. And the Recovery Council got its legs underneath that and just kind of have walked that forwards, and I've gotten the chance to watch that process happen. And seeing people realize that they have the power to change the system has been truly, truly wonderful. You know, people often ask me what my dream is for mental health and mental wellness, you know, in the future. My dream is that there be recovery tools that are available everywhere, where you don't have to find a peer support specialist, you don't have to go to a group, that you should be able to find those materials and be able to afford them even if you smoke and only get $40 a month. My dream is that people get to take charge of their recovery and take control when we have everything based in a system and it's dribbled out at someone else's time frame. You know, the people in this, that are trying to get what they need often can't get what they need because they're not in control. That's my dream, is that people be able to get recovery tools everywhere, like on the street corner. You know, a support group on every corner, you know, recovery tools on every corner. There should be DVDs available on Netflix for downloads for stuff. There should be stuff on YouTube. There should be stuff on blogs. And it should all be able to be linked together. And I think we need to be able to get to the good information. You know, it's hard sometimes finding good information about mental health.